A clause of another of the 12 says she admits having threatened with death those who would not obey her. Distinctly false. Another clause says she declares that all she has done has been done by command of God. What she really said was all that she had done well, a correction made by herself, as you have already seen. Another of the 12 says she claims that she has never committed any sin. She never made any such claim. Another makes the wearing of the male dress a sin. If it was, she had high Catholic authority for committing it, that of the Archbishop of Reims and the Tribunal of Poitiers. The 10th article was resentful against her for pretending that St. Catherine and St. Marguerite spoke French and not English, and were French in their politics. The 12 were to be submitted first to the learned doctors of theology of the University of Paris for approval. They were copied out and ready by the night of April 4th. Then Marchand did another bold thing. He wrote in the margin that many of the 12 put statements in Joan's mouth which were the exact opposite of what she had said. That fact would not be considered important by the University of Paris, and would not influence its decision or stir its humanity, in case it had any, which it hadn't when acting in a political capacity, as at present. But it was a brave thing for that good Manchon to do, all the same. The 12 were sent to Paris next day, April 5th. That afternoon there was a great tumult in Rouen, and excited crowds were flocking through all the chief streets, chattering and seeking for news. For a report had gone abroad that Joan of Arc was sick until death. In truth, these long séances had worn her out, and she was ill indeed. The heads of the English party were in a state of consternation. For if Joan should die uncondemned by the church and go to the grave unsmirched, the pity and the love of the people would turn her wrongs and sufferings and death into a holy martyrdom, and she would be even a mightier power in France dead than she had been when alive. The Earl of Warwick and the English Cardinal Winchester hurried to the castle and sent messengers flying for physicians. Warwick was a hard man, a rude, coarse man, a man without compassion. There lay the sick girl stretched in her chains in her iron cage, not an object to move man to ungentle speech, one would think. Yet Warwick spoke right out in her hearing, and said to the physicians,
"Mind you take good care of her. The King of England has no mind to have her die a natural death. She is dear to him, for he bought her dear, and he does not want her to die, save at the stake. Now then, mind you cure her."
The doctors asked Joan what had made her ill. She said the Bishop of Beauvais had sent her a fish, and she thought it was that. Then Jean d'Estivet burst out on her and called her names and abused her. He understood Joan to be charging the bishop with poisoning her, you see, and that was not pleasing to him, for he was one of Cochon's most loving and conscienceless slaves, and it outraged him to have Joan injure his master in the eyes of these great English chiefs, these being men who could ruin Cochon, and would promptly do it if they got the conviction that he was capable of saving Joan from the stake by poisoning her and thus cheating the English out of all the real value gainable by her purchase from the Duke of Burgundy. Joan had a high fever, and the doctors proposed to bleed her. Warwick said,
"Be careful about that. She is smart and is capable of killing herself."
He meant that to escape the stake she might undo the bandage and let herself bleed to death, but the doctors bled her anyway, and then she was better. Not for long, though. Jean d'Estivet could not hold still, he was so worried and angry about the suspicion of poisoning which Joan had hinted at, so he came back in the evening and stormed at her till he brought the fever all back again. When Warwick heard of this, he was in a fine temper, you may be sure, for here was his prey threatening to escape again, and all through the overzeal of this meddling fool. Warwick gave d'Estivet a quite admirable cursing, admirable as to strength, I mean, for it was said by persons of culture that the art of it was not good, and after that the meddler kept still. Joan remained ill more than 2 weeks. Then she grew better. She was still very weak, but she could bear a little persecution now without much danger to her life. It seemed to Cochon a good time to furnish it. So he called together some of his doctors of theology and went to her dungeon. Manchon and I went along to keep the record, that is, to set down what might be useful to Cochon and leave out the rest. The sight of Joan gave me a shock. Why, she was but a shadow. It was difficult for me to realize that this frail little creature, with a sad face and drooping form, was the same Joan of Arc that I had so often seen, all fire and enthusiasm, charging through a hail of death and the lightning and thunder of the guns at the head of her battalions. It wrung my heart to see her looking like this. But Cochon was not touched. He made another of those conscienceless speeches of his, all dripping with hypocrisy and guile. He told Joan that among her answers had been some which had seemed to endanger religion, and as she was ignorant and without knowledge of the Scriptures, he had brought some good and wise men to instruct her, if she desired it. Said he, "We are churchmen, and disposed by our good will as well as by our vocation to procure for you the salvation of your soul and your body in every way in our power, just as we would do the like for our nearest kin or for ourselves. In this, we but follow the example of Holy Church, who never closes the refuge of her bosom against any that are willing to return.